Where you can get done down. A gas station. For loud music. And you can pull off 10 shots at a gas station. Endangering everybody else's life. Because at a gas station, there's gas. If one of those bullets hit the pump, we've got massive explosion, we've got a bomb. You're scared because you've seen what you think is a shotgun, and you've been able to pull off 10 shots with a 9mm, and they have not been able to pull off one. Not a Uzi where you just press, pull the trigger and it just fires. Help us over here. And so I'm asking you to continue to pray for young people. They will sing for Jesus. But they will be involved with what God wants them to be involved with. They won't come under the enemy's fire. I thought it very significant that they're trying that case during February. Black History Month. I don't know if the verdict is out, but I'm sure it's not, because I think if it was, I would have heard. But it's going to be interesting. For in 2 years, there are 2 youngsters, young men, 17-year-olds, who've been gunned down when they're unarmed. Before I go into the message, I hope that the young people are listening to me, and especially the young men. Because you live here in these United States, you're a threat. Just because you're young and black. And especially because you're male. And so I'm saying to all the young men, be careful how you govern yourself from day to day. You can't do like everybody else does. It's not fair. But death is not fair. And when you're in the casket, fear doesn't matter anymore. Whether it was fear or not fear. Know where you are. Know your situation. Know your surroundings. And know how you need to govern yourself. This may sound like a prejudicial statement. But one of my sons called me a few years ago and said that, well, he didn't call me, his grandma, who he stays with, called me and said that your son wants to grow dreads. And I drove down to Vero Beach and had a talk with the young man. I said, listen, you already, because you're black, and because you're male, and because you're young, you're already a suspect. Please do not add anything else. I'm not saying to the parents, don't allow your children, I'm just telling you what I did with mine. I'm not saying to the young men that you can't do what you want to do, because you're here. I'm just saying to you this. Don't add fear factors, because folk already fear you, because you're dark skinned, because you're male, because you're young. When you add dreads, you even look more dreadful, more fearful. That's why The lion is the king of the jungle because he's got this mane with his roar that even when he doesn't roar, just by looking at him, all the other rest of the animals are in fear. Are you hearing me? You don't have to believe me. Might look like a nice fashion to you. And yes, when you're young, hair is very important. And I realized that. As I got older, I realized hair is overrated. Yeah, that's because it's receding. Yeah. But hair is overrated. It's Black History Month. Just wanted to bring you a snippet. Again, so that you understand that we are a people that are proud of who we are. Amen. And I want you to know that we have come too far. We've come too far to be involved in foolishness. Amen. My wife was going over some stuff with me last night as she's preparing a little snippet to do for an AY program. And again, I realize that all of us who are here as Black people are here because it was only the fittest of the fittest that survived. And that so many of our ancestors died because of the amount of oppression that they were under. That the only reason that we are here is simply because our foreparents were able, by the grace of Almighty God, to overcome the physical, mental, emotional atrocities that were living against us. We've come too far to act foolish. We've come too far. Ben Carson was born in Detroit, Michigan on September 18, 1951. His mother, though undereducated herself, pushed her sons to read and to believe in themselves. Carson went from being a poor student to receiving honors, and he eventually attended medical school. Poor don't mean you have to be stupid or dumb. Amen? As a doctor, he became the director of pediatric neurosurgery at John Hopkins Hospital at age 33, and became famous for his groundbreaking work of separating conjoined twins. He's got a brother by the name of Benjamin. By the name of Curtis. Carson's mother was frugal with the family's finances, cleaning and patching clothes from the Goodwill in order to dress the boys. The family would also go to local farms and offer to pick corn or other vegetables in exchange for a portion of the yield. She would then can the produce for the kids' meal. Her actions and the way she managed the family have proved to be a tremendous influence in Ben and Curtis's life. Ben went on to study hard and did so well during high school that he won a scholarship to Yale University. Let me stop here. Too many of our young men think it is not cool to study. And they think it is cool to play the fool in school. And it's not. It is not. And just because you're poor doesn't mean that you can't achieve. He received his bachelor's degree from Yale in 1973. He had always dreamed of becoming a doctor and was very interested in psychiatry. But once in medical school at the University of Michigan, he realized he was good with his hands and set his sights on neurosurgery. After completing medical school in 1977, He was one of the few graduates and the first black accepted in the residency program at Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore. In 1983, because of a shortage of neurosurgeons in Australia, Carson was offered a chief neurosurgical residency at Queen Elizabeth II Medical Center in Perth, where he gained a great deal of operating experience. He returned to Johns Hopkins in 1984, and after a year, he was promoted to the director of pediatric neurosurgery, becoming one of the youngest doctors in the country to head such a division. You can read more about Dr. Carson, but one of the things that I'm proud of is the fact that Dr. Carson is black, gifted, but also a Seventh-day Adventist. I challenge the young people, you can be whatever you want to be by the grace of Almighty God. For our God restores, even though you may be wearing clothes from Goodwill right now.
Right.
Carson was wearing Goodwill clothes, but now he's in a position that he can wear clothes from anywhere he wants to buy. My word to the young people is this. Your parents may be poor right now, but if you set your sights on education and the heights that God will bring you to, then you don't have to stay there, and you can always bring yourself up. Yes, while you may think that it is degrading right now, set your sights on things that is to come, and God will restore. Bow your heads with me, please, while we pray. Gracious God, our loving Father, you are a God who is a healer and a restorer. We've just read about Ben Carson, who is a healer. But he's not doing that of his own power. It's your knowledge and your skill that is in him that has brought him thus far. Father, we ask that you will help us to remember that you are a healer and a restorer, and that there's nothing impossible with you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. St. Mark chapter 1, verses 40 to 45. Scripture reading that was so eloquently read by one of our young people. And we are continuing to use our young people, amen, on the platform, amen, so that they can know that we know that they are a part of our church. Mark chapter 1, verses 40 to 44. Records for us what, according to the Seventh-day Adventist Bible commentary, is the seventh miracle of Jesus Christ while he was here on earth. Remember, from the beginning of the year, we've been talking about miracles. We've done first, we've done third, we've done fourth. Now, we are doing the seventh miracle. The seventh miracle happens actually to be the first healing that Jesus did of a leper. You may not fully understand what the significance of healing leprosy is. But I want you to understand that leprosy in Jesus' day was the most dreaded of all diseases. It was one that when you got it, you couldn't get rid of it. It continued to progress until you died. It was a disease that affected the skin, and your skin would look like it had sores and scales on it, and it did have. And as the disease progressed, your appendages would fall off. So your fingers would fall off one by one, and your toes would fall off one by one, and then you would start to lose your wrist and your arm and your feet, and it was a slow, painful death. It was one where you had open sores and you stunk. It was one where you were diagnosed. You were diagnosed by the priest. You had to go to the priest, and the priest would say that yes, you had leprosy. And if the priest said you had leprosy, you'd have to leave home. You couldn't mingle with the rest of other individuals. You had to go out and just be in what was called a leper's colony. When you have the chance. Not now. Google leprosy and you will see what some of the individuals look like. If you don't have a strong stomach, your heart will pain you as you see what leprosy is even still doing to individuals in less developed countries than we have right now. We've got a cure for leprosy now. There are antidotes, antibiotics, all the kind of stuff that is for leprosy. But in Jesus' day, there was no such thing. As a matter of fact, the leper, if he or she were to approach those who did not have leprosy, that leper was required to announce himself. Not, hello, I'm Mark Brown. No. The way that you had to announce yourself as you approach a group of people is by saying, unclean! 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 And with saying unclean, everybody knew what you had. They would move out of the way. Because it was felt that it is contagious, and it is contagious, and it was also felt that even if you breathe the air that a leper breathed out, you could catch leprosy. Here, in Jesus' time, there were several lepers that were around, that lived outside of Jerusalem in various lepers' colonies. They could not have a chance to go back and intermingle with their families until they were healed. And the only way that you were healed is if the priest said you were healed. This particular leper, I heard that Jesus had done great things. He had heard that Jesus had healed the man that was at the pool of Bethesda. He heard that man who was there for 38 years and could not move, that paralytic, was able to, by the grace of Almighty God, get up and use limbs that had not been used for 38 years. Something in the leper's mind said, if I could only get to this Jesus, my leprosy could be healed. But he has a challenge. How is he going to get to Jesus? Everywhere that Jesus went, and everywhere that Jesus went, he was surrounded by a throng of individuals who was always there waiting to hear what Jesus had to say. How is this leper going to penetrate that crowd and get close enough for him to catch the attention of Jesus? Well, as he thought it through, he decided that, you know what? Crowd or no crowd. People are no people. I'm going to get to Jesus one way or another. You see, there are some of us who are sincere, but we prevent other people from getting, from allowing us to get to Jesus. You see, we're looking at folk in the church and how they're acting, and we're saying if they are the deacon, then they're the deaconesses, if he's the pastor, and he is acting like that, then I don't want to get to Jesus. But I'm here to say to you, don't let anybody stop you from getting to Jesus. No matter what kind of situation you may be in, this leper with the condition that he was in, I don't know if by then the disease had taken a hand or both hands. I don't know if the disease had taken a foot or both feet. I don't know if only he had just stumps to walk on. I don't know that, but the leper did not think about that. All his focus was on is, I need to get to Jesus. I need to get to the healer. I need to get to the man of the father. I need to get to the one who can remedy my situation. I need to get to the one who can change my situation and get me back in good stead. So I don't have to shout out, unclean, unclean, as I go back. I need to be able to interact with my family one more time. I need to be able to feel the touch of somebody. I wish I had a witness in here. Scripture says that this leper mustered up the courage. Yeah. Stay with me now. This leper has spotted Jesus. He spotted Jesus simply because he saw a crowd around somebody who's teaching, and he said that must be Jesus. Watch with me now while the rest of the lepers must be saying to him, what are you doing there? As he is approaching the crowd. The rest of the lepers are probably saying, what are you doing? You know you can't do that. You know you can't go up in that church. Look at you. You don't have the right clothes. You don't smell right. You don't look right. You're missing parts of your body. You need to stay away from that people. As a matter of fact, they had dumped you as the outcast. But Jesus' mission is to seek and to save those who are lost. Come with me now as this leper approaches the periphery. And he does not want to make a big scene, but as he approaches those who are on the outside of where of the crowd, I can hear him approaching somebody, and he whispers, unclean? Unclean? Somebody looks around and sees this grotesque individual, somebody from the living dead. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Somebody who looks like they're from the living dead and they move over. And there is a partition, and as he comes to somebody else, he says, unclean. And they look around and they see him and they move over. And he does that all the way till there is the last person that is standing where Jesus is, and he whispers, unclean. And that person jumps back. The pen of inspiration said that there were individuals who were trying to stop him from getting to Jesus, but he didn't see them, but they were too scared to go up and physically touch him. So here they are, and they're trying to stop him, but and right as he gets to the feet of Jesus, he doesn't stand there, but the Master, I know that you can make me clean. What he is actually saying is not my will, but thine be done. I know you've got the power to heal me. Heal me if you will. You must understand that leprosy was also a disease that was not just in the minds of the Israelites something that came upon you because of a physical ailment. It was a spiritual ailment. That in Israel, it was because of some dreaded sin that you obviously had committed while you got leprosy. And so here, Jesus is in the midst of a man who is not just physically ill, but also spiritually ill. And he's saying, I know you can heal me, but according to your will, would you do it for me? My first point is this. No matter what kind of sin, no matter what kind of malady, the worst kind, Jesus is available and willing to heal of it. No matter how far in sin and degradation that you are, because in Israel, one who is a leper couldn't get any low in society than leprosy. If thou wilt, make me clean. It had been 800 years before that a leper had been cleansed. Naaman the leper went down into the muddy water 800 years before. As a matter of fact, Naaman was not even a Jew. Naaman wasn't even a Jew. So to that point, no Jew had ever got healing from a leprosy. Here is this man, he is extending faith beyond the wildest imagination. But he has enough faith to know that if Jesus is God, and Jesus was God, and is God, that Jesus could heal him. So he said, please heal me. Please, Lord. The word of God said Jesus was moved with compassion and reached out and did what the social status of that time said you should not do. And instead of just speaking the word, Jesus reached out and touched the leper. That was a no-no, for nobody is supposed to touch a leper unless you've got leprosy yourself. But Jesus understood that there is therapy in touch. Yeah. And that as human beings, we all need to get touched by another human being. You need to understand that there are some individuals whose health is not good simply because no other human being is touching them. The touch, the nurturing touch of a hug builds trust. This is, let me back up a little bit. This is studied from Virginia Satir, who is a family therapist. And she is saying that we as individuals need 4 hugs a day to survive. Amen? Praise the name of Jesus. 4 hugs a day to survive. We need 8 hugs a day for maintenance. And we need 12 hugs a day for growth. Maybe the reason why some of us are stunted is because we're not getting enough hugs. Turn to the next person and say, I need a hug. Thank you. she presents 10 things that a hug or a touch can do. She says the nurturing touch of a hug builds trust and a sense of safety. Number two, hugs can insistently boost oxytocin levels, which heal feelings of loneliness, isolation, and anger.
Amen.
Number three, holding a hug for an extended time lifts one's serotonin level, elevating mood and creating happiness. Number four, hugs strengthen the immune system. Have mercy, Jesus. Hugs strengthen the immune system. I know that's why I tell you that we need to have fellowship time, because some of us only get hugs on Sabbath. And those spouses that are hiding hugs from other spouses, you're killing them. Those parents that are hiding hugs from their children, you're killing them. Number five, hugging boosts self-esteem. From the time we're born, our family's touch show us that we are loved and that we are special. Hugging relaxes muscles. Hugging releases tension in the body. Hugs, number seven, balance out the nervous system. Number eight, hugs teach us how to give and receive. Number nine, hugs are so much like meditation and laughter. They teach us how to let go and be present in the moment. And number 10, the energy exchange between the people hugging is as an investment in the relationship. Jesus understood that this man didn't just need to be told he's clean, he needed a touch.
Yes.
He hadn't been touched for however long he had this malady. And my Lord just went against all the dictates of society and reached out and touched that man. I want to let you know that we serve a compassionate God.
Yes.
A God of feeling. A God who knows what you need when you need it.
Yes.
A God who can heal whenever you want healing. A God who hears and answers your prayers. Here's the man, he's worshiping God, and he gets up, and Jesus touches him and says, you are healed. I want you also to know that you are worshiping a God who understands the laws of the time. And Jesus said to him, go show yourself to the priest. Don't tell anybody. You want to know why Jesus told him not to tell anybody? Jesus knew that the priests were so prejudiced against him, Jesus, that if word had gotten to the priest that it was Jesus who had done the healing, even though now the man had all his skin back like a baby, maybe all his fingers and all his toes, all the blotches, everything was cleaned up, he looked well, the priest, because of their prejudice against Jesus, would have said to the man, no, you still have leprosy. So Jesus had to say to the man, don't tell anybody. Don't show yourself to the priest. As a matter of fact, when you go and show yourself to the priest, also take the offering. Have mercy, Jesus. Where is a leper going to get an offering from? But obviously, Jesus knew that the man could afford it. And wherever he was to get it from, he said, bring an offering. My simple message is this. There is a fountain filled with blood. Drawn from Emmanuel's bed. And sinners plunge beneath it. It was all their guilt.
Amen.
There's another song that says, oh, now I see the crimson wave, the fountain deep and wide. Jesus, my Lord, mighty to save, points to his wounded side. A cleansing stream, I see, I plunge, I know he cleanseth me. Oh, praise the Lord, he cleanseth me, he cleanseth me. Yes, he cleanseth me. Pray for me, please. For the whatever appeal song you have. Let me say this in closing. The most dreaded disease Jesus was able to cleanse then, the most dreaded disease of sin, Jesus is able to cleanse now. I want you to listen to me carefully. So those of you who are meditating, come out of your meditation and listen to me. I pulled up the news just this week, CNN, on my tablet, and found another story that, to me, is very heartbreaking. There's a gentleman that made the news whose name is Justin Vollmer. He's a deaf minister. Has been ministering for 28 years. And this week, he announced to the world that he has become an atheist. Listen to me now. I brought the name of another gentleman to you earlier on, the name of Ryan, the Seventh-day Adventist minister, whose New Year's resolution at the beginning of the year was that he would become an atheist this year. Here now is the second minister. This minister, the second minister, this Justin Vollmer, is not a Seventh-day Adventist, but has been ministering in different ways for the past 28 years. Part of what he said was that was troubling to me. He said that after 28 years of ministry, he started to search the Bible. And after 28 years of ministry, now he starts to search the Bible and comes up with the conclusion that the Bible is a farce. There is no God. There is no Jesus. These stories in here are nothing but a fable. And that he no longer believes in the Word of God. He now calls himself an atheist. You can Google it. Justin Vollmer. He had a ministry even on the internet where he did sign language. He preached in sign language. Now he said he doesn't want to be a hypocrite anymore. And so now he is an atheist. I don't know about you, but I believe the Word of God. I was discussing this with a friend, and I said to this friend, let's just for a minute say that everything in here is a fable. Let's just say there is no heaven. Let's just say that all that this book talks about is not true. I would still live by this book because I find it a better code of ethic to live by. And this world cannot to live by it. Church, when the pen of inspiration said that bright lights would flicker and fade, it's happening right now. Believe it or not. Not just in the Adventist church, because Jesus said, of the sheep I have, which are not of this fold. I want you to know that there is a movement out there to topple ministers who are not rooted and grounded in the Word of God. Because they know if they can topple ministers, they can get congregation. And so there's a movement out there where ministers are can go to and say they're now coming out of the closet. Out of the Christian closet. And they're broadening their horizon. Let me say to you this. That's the old trick of the devil. At the tree, the devil said to Eve, you're missing some information. Let me give you some more information. The issue is this. Christians need to be closed-minded.
Yes.
And only closed around the Word of God.
That's right. That's right.
My God is a healer. I believe that with all my heart. Because He has healed me, and He has healed the several of you from the malady of sin and degradation. And so I say to you today, if there is somebody here who wants to, at this point in time, come forward and say, Pastor, why don't you petition the throne of grace on my behalf for that same Jesus who healed that leprous man? I know He has the power to heal me today, and I want to experience that. I'm asking you to come forward. I don't make long appeals. I'm just asking you to come forward. Just a prayer. I'm not asking you to come and join the church. I'm just asking you to come forward for prayer. Beneath the flood, lose all their guilty sin.
Outcast.
of society. He was deplorable looking. He was deplorable smelling. He had lost limbs. He had lost the human touch. Had no more fingers. His face had blotches. He had open sores. He had numbness that he could even pick up something hot and not realize it. For that's what happens to a lot of lepers. They even get cut and don't know until it is infected, because there's no feeling in those areas. But you went past the social mores of that time, stretched out your hand while everybody else backed away from that leper, and you touched that leper because you knew that that man needed a sympathetic, healing, comforting touch. You could have not spoken the word, but you knew he also needed a human touch, a touch from somebody who was whole. Yes, he had been bumped by other lepers, but scorned by everybody else who was whole. We're gathered here together, Lord Jesus, in this semicircle, saying that we know the leprosy of sin is working away at different parts of us. But we're asking you, Lord Jesus, just as that leper was beseeching you, that you will touch us with your healing hand. And you will then pronounce us well. Father, we thank you. For we read that when that leprous man got his healing, even though you gave him a specific command, he was so overjoyed that he couldn't keep it to himself. He was so overjoyed that he even made your ministry a little bit ruined in that area. It says in the Bible that from that point on, you had to go out in a desert place to minister. You couldn't minister in that area anymore because your fame had gone so far afield. Come, oh, that we could get that touch today. Oh, that we could announce your name so much that individuals will know who the divine healer is.
Yes.
Father, we thank you, for we know that the power to heal back then is just as potent as the power to heal right now. And so we say, hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus, for your saving power. I bring to you, Lord Jesus, those ministers who are wavering in their belief of you, who have turned their backs on you and have decided to become atheists. Lord, reach out and touch them, Jesus. Reach out and heal them from the leprosy of sin and unbelief, so that they can get back to the first love. Lord, we thank you for hearing and answering our prayers in Jesus' name. Let everyone say, amen.